Our first stop in our tour of private collections takes us to Salcedo Auctions in Makati, where the auction house celebrates its 15th anniversary with a series of exhibitions featuring the private collections of prominent Filipino collectors like the Bautistas. Over the decades, Edwin Bautista, the president and CEO of Union Bank, and his wife Eileen have amassed a vast collection of rare artifacts and precious objects connected to Philippine history. And though what you see here is only a fraction of what they own, pieces curated by Floyd Quintos, woven together to help tell the story of Filipino identity and nationhood through these objects.
Yeah, but what even got you into collecting pieces of history, as opposed to what other men could collect?
Well, initially, in the case of ceramics, they were just nice objects that you could use to decorate your place. So if you're gonna put something on the table, might as well put something that's something that you like. And I've always been drawn to history, prehistory. Mm. I love the idea of researching, of finding out more, and what role they played in our history or prehistory.
So what was that piece that started it all? Is it still here with you?
It was a Swatow plate similar to that blue and white one. And that's why I thought of putting a Swatow blue and white, because to me, when you talk about Chinese ceramics, antique, the thing that comes into my mind first and foremost is blue and white. And not just any blue and white, but that Swatow blue and white, which is a Ming Dynasty plate.
Most collectors of rare historical artifacts often begin with Chinese ceramics, which are much easier to source since the Chinese have been trading with the natives of the islands long before the Spanish colonial conquest and way up to the galleon trade. Edwin started collecting ceramics in his early 20s and now has one of the most important there is.
What began as just curiosity and aesthetic pleasure turned into
a lifelong pursuit.
A lifelong pursuit and a deeper understanding of our own history.
Yes.
And culture.
Correct. So, yeah, ceramics, and then I got my wife interested.
A collector's passion is often infectious, and one's family is usually the first to be infected by the bug. For Eileen, it was pre-Hispanic gold and jewelry, a private collection that now rivals the most established museums in the Philippines. Indeed, collectors are often portrayed as bored, wealthy people obsessed with a hunt. And though the Bautistas started out as curious hobbyists collecting for personal pleasure, their collection of historical artifacts has become a portal to the misunderstood past of the Filipino nation and its undervalued cultural heritage.
And how would you put that in relation to the way you organize this exhibition? What would someone coming in here without deep knowledge of these pieces feel? What do you want them to feel?
So that number one, the last 400 years has been a struggle for nationhood. It's about finding who we are, what we are as a nation, and that there were earlier ups and downs. You have the 100 plus years ago, we thought we will emerge from this as an independent nation.
Indeed, snippets of Filipino history, usually only seen by scholars or printed in obscure catalogs, can now be viewed by all here. And Edwin takes me through some of his favorite acquisitions, objects that tell a story of the nation.
And this is one of them, right?
Our birth certificate.
And you say that because?
Because it's the first time that a map mentions the name Filipinas over there. Giovanni Ramuscio has heard from records that he obtained in Portugal that a certain Roy Lopez de Villalobos had named one of the islands Filipina. Okay, one of the islands, actually, So he used Filipina not for the whole Philippine Islands, but for Leyte. Because Villalobos only named Leyte. In fact, that was the intent.
Collecting rare maps reveal much more than just geographical details. They often reveal the context of discoveries often lost to history, like the misnomer that is the Philippines.
And it's unusual also from an aesthetic point of view because it's
inverted.
It's inverted.
Because that's the Arabic way.
Another ancient map with historical significance for the Philippines is the same one at the center of current debates.
Historians and modern diplomats would be looking at these maps again.
They would be looking at these maps. They were all based on Murillo Velarde. This was a map by done by a Spaniard in Madrid. And it says there, you have Bajo de Masinloc. So it was ours from the beginning. You have there, Bajo de Masinloc, Panakot. So whenever they showed the possessions of the Philippines, it was always there. There you have. This is
exactly.
This is a small version of the Murillo Velarde map.
Yet another map Edwin is proud to have is an original copy of the same one used by American and Spanish diplomats during the Treaty of Paris.
And here we are. Okay. I'm trying to buy the Philippines from you. So you're trying to tell me what you own. What am I going to get for what I'm going to pay
for? It's amazing and sad at the same time when you think about our country being sold.
Right. And while this is happening, well, look who's watching over us.
No, seriously? Okay, that was just for show.
For display, but that was the idea.
So the Treaty of Paris was concluded or was being negotiated.
Yes,
1898. This is what the diplomats were looking at.
This is what they were looking at, exactly. And so they finally settled on $20 million. So initially the Spaniards wanted more. Mm. The Americans wanted to pay less, obviously. Mm. That's called bargaining.
While maps give us a better sense of history from the point of view of the powerful men who planned a future of nations, it's weapons and flags like these that narrate the history from those who do the actual fighting and bloodletting on the ground.
The flags are impressive. Where'd you get these flags?
From the US. They were war booties captured by the victors.
Which is what all victors do.
Yes, they do.
Throughout history. After a victory in a battlefield.
Of course.
They don't just take souvenirs. They don't just take the banners, the flags. They take the weapons as well.
Right.
It's pretty much this yes. War booty room.
Yeah. So normally, the generals are the ones who would take home the flags. Ah. And the ordinary privates would.
I see.
Take home the regular ones.
Unlike the Balangiga bells, for example, flags and weapons retrieved from the battlefield were easier to transport and to keep. Descendants of soldiers who fought in the Philippines have begun selling such war booty back to Filipino collectors like Edwin.
So one of these could have been the flag of Gregorio del Pilar. We don't know.
And this is interesting because it has the 1st Montana Infantry.
That one was just sewn in by the...
As a souvenir.
As a souvenir.
Were once personal souvenirs of war are now national treasures. Flags, guns, and swords that reveal the hopes and aspirations of freedom fighters, most of which never survived the ravages of war and time, but preserved by collectors like Edwin.